Hello, good afternoon. I hope you will be well and in terms of health in your homes. So, in the last lecture, we studied about the introduction to epidemiology, the various components of epidemiology, the aims of epidemiology, and we try to look epidemiology through the prism of this current COVID-19 pandemic in order to understand epidemiology in a more interesting way, in an easier way, in a handy way. So today I will share with you the important terms in epidemiology, and particularly the infectious disease epidemiology, because the infectious disease epidemiology is very important in current context, and the various terms, important definitions in which comes under infectious disease epidemiology, you should know. They are often asked in as a short note in theory papers, and it is also asked in Viva, and one should know if one wants to read epidemiology in a great detail way. So definitions in epidemiology is important for reporting, for planning and implementation of health prevention and control programs. We have seen the definition last time, and that definition, how we have seen how over the years that definition got evolved, and every medical student should know these definitions for future use. So the importance of infectious epidemiology, because epidemiology is a very broad term, and you will divide in infectious disease epidemiology these days, and there are other epidemiologies also of various health related states or events, but we are dealing here in this session particularly the terms which are associated with infectious disease epidemiology. So importance of infectious disease epidemiology, epidemiological knowledge, then through epidemiological knowledge we can do epidemiological activities like disease reporting, measurement of morbidity and mortality. It's one of the one of the important aims of epidemiology, prevention and control of the disease. So starting with an agent. So what is an agent means? Agent is a substance. It can be a living or non-living, or a force, or the excessive presence or relative lack of which may initiate a disease process is known as agent in epidemiology, right? So for example, a biological agent can be bacteria, viruses, fungi. In terms of nutrients, carbohydrate, protein, fat, lack and excess of that can produce initiate a disease process. Physical agent, any physical agent, excessive heat or lesser heat, cold, excessive cold, radiation, chemical agents, uric acid, bilirubin, etc. These are just examples, there can be many. So an agent is a substance, living or non-living, or a force, the excess presence or relative lack of which may initiate a disease process is known as an agent in a broad term in epidemiology. Infection, what do you mean by the term infection? Infection is defined as entry and development or multiplication of an infectious agent in the body of any other host of man or any other animals is known as infection. in fiction is entry and development or multiplication of infectious agent. And transmission of infection is defined as spread of infectious agent through the environment or to another person from the reservoir and the source. We will see in great detail what is the term reservoir means, what is the term source means. Contamination. Contamination, this is a term which we use vaguely in very different ways, but what in epidemiology, what contamination means, presence of an infectious agent on a body surface or substances like clothes, beddings, toys, surgical instruments, dressings, including water, milk and food, fomites. So it is known as contamination. Example, water contamination. Any presence of any infectious agent on a body surface or substances like clothes, beddings, toys and surgical instruments or dressings, including water, milk and food, known as contamination. Infestation. What do you mean by infestation? These are very important terms in epidemiology, particularly the infectious disease epidemiology. Infestation, the lodgment, development and reproduction of arthropods on the surface of the body of person or animal is known as infestation. It deals specifically with arthropods because arthropod borne disease forms a very large section in infectious disease epidemiology. That's why the term infestation is reserved for the lodgment, development and reproduction of arthropods on the surface of body of person or animal. For example, an example of infestations such as scabies, which is caused by Sarcoptus scar and pediculosis. So these are the important examples of infestation. Now, host. In epidemiology and particularly in infectious disease epidemiology, person or animal, including birds and arthropods that affords lodgement to an infectious agent under natural conditions is known as host. There are further various categories of host, but this term is very important. We often use the term in epidemiological triad also. We try to explain the occurrence of disease in terms of agent, host and environmental factors, how these three elements, they interact with each other and cause the occurrence of disease or the causation of disease. So host is any person or any animal, including birds and arthropods, that affords lodgement to an infectious agent under natural conditions. These definitions are formed after very due consultation over a period of time. That's why they are important, and they are absolute definition, and changes often do occur in definitions. Talking about the various different categories of hosts, it can be an obligatory host. For example, man in measles, this is our obligatory host. Definitive host, malaria, cyclin, mosquito, definitive host. Intermediate host, malaria, cyclin, man, example of intermediate host. Definitive host is one where the infectious agent completes its cycle of development or the sexual maturation takes place, definitive host. Contagious disease. Disease that is transmitted through contact is known as contagious disease. Scabies, pediculosis, leprosy, STIs, there are many examples of contagious disease. Communicable disease. The definition of communicable disease is an illness due to specific infectious agent or its toxic product capable of being directly or indirectly transmitted from man to man or animal to animal or animal to man or from environment to man or from animal is known as a communicable disease. Examples are many, including the current COVID-19 pandemic. What is an epidemic? Epidemic is the unusual occurrence in a community or a region of the cases of an illness or any other health related events clearly in excess of expected occurrence. Now, excess of expected occurrence, we measure it, we quantify it. For example, if the frequency, the disease frequency during that particular period has raised talking statistically, if it is plus 2 standard deviation, is more than plus 2 standard deviation, so we can say it's an epidemic. We will compare the disease frequency with the data within previous years, and if we are seeing an excess, it is known as an epidemic. So unusual occurrence in a community or region of cases of an illness or any other health related events, the term epidemic is not restricted to any disease. It can be applied to any other health related events also. Clear in excess of expected occurrence, it is known as epidemic. Examples are many. This particular pandemic started as an epidemic. Other examples being gastroenteritis, hepatitis A, there are many. Endemic, what do you mean by endemic? Endemic, it refers to the constant presence of a disease or infectious agent within a given geographical area. That is endemic. Constant presence, there is a steady presence of disease or infectious agent within a given geographical area or population group without importation from outside. This is important, the last, the tail of the definition. Without importation from outside is known as endemic. For example, malaria is endemic in many parts of India. Typhoid is also endemic in many parts of India. That can be seen as an example of endemic diseases. This is very important. These terms, epidemic, endemic, it refers to the constant presence of disease or infectious agent within a given geographical area or population group without importation from outside. Now, what is the endemic is further divided into hyperendemic and holoendemic. Hyperendemic, the disease is constantly present in the region and affects all age groups, is known as hyperendemic. And holoendemic means the rate of infection is high in children, in pediatric age group, and lesser in adults. So can be hyperendemic and lower endemic. So sporadic, what do you mean by the term sporadic? Sporadic is the cases occur irregularly, haphazardly, from time to time, and generally infrequently. So this is what means sporadic. The term sporadic means in infectious disease epidemiology, cases occur irregularly, haphazardly, from time to time, and generally infrequently. Sporadic means scattered about. So irregularly they are occurring is known as sporadic. Can be example rabies, herpes, tetanus, meningococcal meningitis can be seen as an example of sporadic diseases. Pandemic. Now this term is used more often these days, is the COVID-19 pandemic. Pandemic, this definition is very important. Pandemic and epidemic. Pandemic is always started as an epidemic. So an epidemic affecting a large proportion of population, occurring over a wide geographical area such as nation or a continent or world, is known as pandemic, which crosses the geographical areas, the national geographical limits. This is known as pandemic. So an epidemic affecting a large proportion of population occurring over a wide geographical area such as nation, a continent or world is known as a pandemic. And example being this COVID-19 pandemic, previously influenza, the Spanish flu pandemic, the SARS, the MERS, as discussed in the last lecture. Zoonosis. What is zoonosis? An infection or infectious disease transmitted under natural conditions from vertebrate animals to man is known as zoonosis. An infection or infectious disease transmitted under natural conditions. There has need not to be an artificial condition or artificial environment. An infection or infectious disease transmitted under natural conditions from vertebrate animals to man is known as zoonosis. Examples are many. There is a whole section of infectious disease which comes under zoonosis, a very important section in community medicine. Examples being rabies, plague, anthrax, brucellosis, salmonellosis. These are the examples of zoonosis. Further, zoonosis can be divided into anthropozoonosis or zooanthroponosis based on the infections transmitted from vertebrate animal to man, or infections transmitted from man to vertebrate animals. So this is a little further division of zoonosis out of the many divisions of zoonosis. Nosocomial infection. What do you mean by nosocomial infection? An infection originating in a patient while in a hospital or other healthcare facility is known as nosocomial infection. For example, wound infection, particularly a surgical wound, when it gets infected, it is usually a nosocomial infection. One of the most common nosocomial infections are UTIs. Opportunistic infection. What do you mean by opportunistic infection? Is infection by an organism that takes the opportunity provided by a defect in host defense and cause disease. By अपने आपका डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म पूरा डिस्ट्रप्टेड है, वीकेंड है, डेफिशिएंट है, देन इन्फेक्शन बाय एन ऑर्गेनिज्म दैट टेक्स द अपॉर्चुनिटी, वी आर गिविंग दैट ऑर्गेनिज्म एन अपॉर्चुनिटी बाय ड्यू टू लैक ऑफ इम्यूनिटी, दैट इज नोन एज अपॉर्चुनिस्टिक इन्फेक्शन. एग्जाम्पल इन कैंडिडियासिस, क्रिप्टोकोकल मेनिंजाइटिस, पर्टिकुलरली इन एड्स, फुल ब्लोन एड्स पेशेंट. Iatrogenic disease. What do you mean by iatrogenic disease? Any adverse consequences resulting from a physician professional activity or from the professional activity of any other health personnel is known as iatrogenic disease. For example, iatrogenic, any anaphylactic reaction to any antibiotics or any immunoglobulin occurring is clearly an example of iatrogenic disease, because it is resulting from a physician professional activity or professional activity of any other health personnel. Acquiring HIV infection or hepatitis B infection, hepatitis C infection through injection or blood transfusion is also an example of iatrogenic infection. It's very important these days. What do you mean by notifiable diseases? So, notifiable diseases, a disease that is had by statutory requirements must be reported to the public health authority in a pertinent jurisdiction when the diagnosis is made is known as notifiable diseases. For example, this notification of this COVID-19 pandemic, any case you encounter, it has to be notified. Other examples being TB, for example. TB has to be notified, because if we don't, we will not get notified, it will not be get notified, the person will continue to shred the virus or bacteria in the community, which is these days is also a punishable offense if knowingly you are not notifying the disease, be, according to the recent gazette notification by Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, if you are not notifying the disease, it's a punishable offence. In case of tuberculosis, some doctors were booked, initially in Gujarat, later on in other parts of India. So, elimination. What do you mean by elimination? Elimination means interruption of transmission of disease in a given geographical area or region is known as elimination. Sometimes, some people, they oftenly go confuse in the terms of elimination and eradication. Those two are totally different, and they often use the term eradication in a very vague way. So, particularly if you are dealing with these terms, you have to say it with greater depth. And what is elimination? Again, interruption of transmission of disease in a given geographical area or region is known as elimination. Example being elimination of poliomyelitis that happened, and gradually the WHO gave the certificate of polio free, but we are not haven't given the certificate of eradication, because it's a totally different terminology. We'll see what is eradication means. Eradication means this definition, and I have taught you many times, has to be, you know, has to be learned by heart. Termination of all transmission of infection by extermination of the infectious agent is known as eradication. If you are not saying this, the latter part of the definition, that is by extermination of the infectious agent, this the definition is not complete. It's partial definition. So, termination means all transmission of termination, end, virtual or actual end of all transmission of infection by extermination of the infectious agent is known as eradication. For example, smallpox, the termination of all transmission of that particular infectious agent got terminated by extermination of the same. Termination of an infectious infection from the whole world, so that disease will no longer occur in the world. In other words, you can say that. Now, there are potential candidates for eradication, the current being polio and measles. Only two countries or three countries are now reporting poliomyelitis. It's a very good candidate for eradication. Measles too. So again, definitions in epidemiology is important for reporting, planning and implementation of disease prevention and control program. That's why we are reading this these definitions, and every medical student should know these definitions for the future use. Now we will look about the dynamics of disease transmission. What is a source or reservoir of infection? Now, in terms of source and reservoir, we will see, but what is the dynamics of disease transmission is a term mainly applicable for the communicable diseases. We are dealing here only the epidemiology of infectious diseases, important terms. Now, transmission dynamics includes a source or reservoir, the modes of transmission, and a susceptible host. This is mainly involved in the transmission dynamics of the infection. There is a source or reservoir, then it gets transmitted to a susceptible host. The initial phase is like that only. So, source of infection. Source of infection is defined as a person, animal, substance or object from which infectious disease agent is passes or disseminates is known as source of infection. It can be a soil, for example, source of infection for hookworm infestation can be soil, can be sputum, source of infection for tuberculosis. Here in COVID-19, it's also sputum, source of infection. Reservoir of infection. Reservoir of infection is defined as any person, any animal, any arthropod, any plant, any soil or substance or combination of these. Again, reservoir of infection is necessary, can't be a living thing or a non-living thing. It can be a combination of both. Is defined as any person, animal, arthropod, plant, soil or substance in which the infectious agent lives and multiplies, on which it depends primarily for survival, and where it reduces itself in such a manner that it can be transmitted to the susceptible host, is known as reservoir of infection. Example, man is a reservoir of infection for tuberculosis, HIV. For dogs are reservoir for rabies. Rodents are reservoir for plaque. So once again, reservoir, very important definition, is defined as any person, animal, arthropod, plant, soil or any substance in which the infectious agent lives. The infectious agent lives, multiplies, develops, on which it depends primarily for survival, and where it reproduces itself in such a manner that it can be transmitted to the susceptible host, is known as reservoir of infection. Some more diseases, for more examples, we can see reservoirs and sources. In case of tuberculosis, man is a reservoir and sputum is a source of infection. In case of HIV, AIDS, through these examples, you will get to know the terms reservoirs and sources more easily. In cases of HIV and AIDS, man is a reservoir and source are the bodily secretions and bodily fluids. In case of malaria, man and mosquito, they are reservoir, man being the intermediate host, mosquito being the primary host, where the development and the sexual maturation of the agent takes place. Source is the infected blood in case of malaria. Rabies, reservoir being dogs and other animals. Source is saliva, where the virus resides. Measles, in case of measles, which is a good candidate for eradication. The reservoir is man, and the sources are droplets and droplet nuclei. In case of Japanese encephalitis, pigs and birds are the reservoir, and source are infected mosquitoes. In case of cholera, man is a reservoir, and source is unsafe water and food. In cases of typhoid, man is a reservoir, source being unsafe water and food, or contaminated water and food. So you can see a difference between source and reservoir. Source of infection is in an intermediate source, which may or may not be a part of reservoir. So that's how we differentiate between the two. Sometimes the two look alike, but it is not the case. Source of infection is an intermediate source, which may or may not be a part of reservoir. Example, hookworm infestation, source is soil, but the reservoir is man. Through man only, and source being soil is intermediate, and then through man only, the reservoir is mainly man's, and source being through soil, one gets this infection. If you see the classification of reservoirs, it can be a human reservoir, animal reservoir, or non-living reservoir. There can be a homologous reservoir, is one where another member of the same species act as a victim. Man is a principal reservoir for some enteric pathogens like Vibrio cholera, tuberculosis, measles. So in one where one member of the same species act as a victim is known as homologous reservoir. Heterologous reservoir means is applied when infection is derived from reservoir other than the man. For example, in case of rabies. Human reservoir can be classified into cases and carriers, and further this case can be a clinical case, a subclinical case, or a latent case, depending upon what type of which stage of infection, which stage of illness he is harboring, and can be carrier. You can classify via types of carrier on the basis of duration and portal of exit. So human reservoir can be divided into cases and carriers. A case, last time I have shared with you the importance of case definition in infectious disease epidemiology, or for that any other disease epidemiology. First you have to formulate the dimensions of the case, on what, in which ground, on what ground we can say this is a case of this. So case definitions is important, and case is defined as a person in a population or study group identified to be having a particular disease or health disorder or condition under investigation. Criteria to identify a case are, there are clinical criteria, there are biochemical criteria, there are lab investigations which are required for a case definition, as we have seen in the last lecture while defining the case definition for COVID-19. And broadly, presence of infection may be clinical, subclinical, or latent, but a case definition includes all these parameters, all these dimensions of the cases. Now the clinical illness may be mild, moderate, or severe, can be typical, atypical. Epidemiologically, mild cases are more important than moderate or severe cases, because they seek less attention, and they thinking it lightly, they didn't go to a physician. That's why asymptomatic or mild cases are more important than severe cases in infectious, if you are studying infectious disease epidemiology. And from an epidemiologist point of view, in these some studies in this current pandemic also, many studies reveals that 40 to 44% of the cases, they are transmitted asymptomatically, or when the disease become contagious before the incubation period, but actually when the symptoms occurs. So mild cases, they have to treat equally important as moderate or severe cases epidemiologically. As mild cases are ambulating, so they spread infection more than severe cases, which have reduced mobility and usually confined to bed. Now, under the category of human reservoir and cases, there are subclinical cases. They are also referred to as inapparent, covert, misabortive cases. So they are the one and the same. Subclinical cases, very important epidemiologically point of with the epidemiological point of view, because they spread the infectious disease more, subclinical cases. They are also referred to as inapparent, covert, missed, or abortive cases. The infectious agent multiplies in the host but does not manifest itself by clinical signs and symptoms due to good immunity of the host being one of the factors. Thus, the person who are not sick or unknown to themselves and others contribute more to the infectious disease transmission. That's why they are important epidemiologically. They represent the submerged part of the iceberg. If you know the tip of the iceberg phenomena. They present the submerged portion of the iceberg. They do not come under any statistics. They don't seek physicians' attention, but they are very important. These can only be detected in labs by recovery of an organism through blood culture, through antibody response, for example, in hepatitis B by checking HBsAg, by checking anti-HBsAg antibodies. That's why this is an important screening test in case of blood transfusion, by antibody response. Biochemical test, acid phosphatase test, is used in tuberculosis. Skin sensitivity test, for example, in Montu's test, Cassoni's test in hydatid test, Montu's test in tuberculosis, to detect subclinical cases. And proportion of individuals with asymptomatic subclinical cases determines the pathogenicity of the infectious agent. Really, if you see this example of COVID-19, the proportion of asymptomatic and subclinical cases, it's very high. That's why the infectivity during the course of few months, it has spread to the whole world, more than 215 countries of the world. So why? Because the subclinical cases are more, the asymptomatic cases are more. Latent infection. There is another term known as latent infection. In latent infection, the host does not shed the infectious agent, which lies dormant within the host without any symptoms, and often without demonstrable presence in blood, tissues, or bodily secretions of the host. For example, in varicella zoster disease, usually after the infectious period of infectivity has passed, the disease manifestation on the body may remain, but the host does not shed the infectious agent. It's not dangerous for the community. So primary case, the first case of the communicable disease introduced in the population unit being studies, is the primary case. Index case is the first case of a communicable disease which comes to the attention of an investigator, is known as index case. So primary case, first case of a communicable disease introduced in the population unit being studied. Primary case for other geographical locations can be different. And index case is the first case of the communicable disease. So in case of this current COVID-19 pandemic, the index case was in Wuhan city of China. Secondary cases, these are the cases developing from the contact with primary cases. So for example, classmate of first child developing the measles, which happened in last year here in RIMS hostel. The human, if we talk about carriers, carrier is defined as any infected person or animal that harbors a specific infectious agent in absence of any clinical disease and serves as a potential source of infection for others. They are known as carriers, and the factors responsible for production of carriers are inadequate treatment and immune response elicited by the host. They have got their epidemiological importance, that's why we are studying it. They escape the recognition of epidemiologist or physician, and they live normal life among population or community, and they readily infect the susceptible individuals for a long period of time under as soon as the favorable conditions arrives. So that is the definition of carriers and the aspects of carriers. Carriers are also classified on the basis of time zone, on the basis of portal of exit, can be incubatory carriers, can be convalescent carriers, can be healthy carriers, on the basis of duration, can be temporary carriers, can be permanent carriers of the disease. On the portal of exit, they can be urinary carriers, intestinal carriers, respiratory carriers, or other carriers. Incubatory carriers, coming to the incubatory carriers. Incubatory carriers, those who shed the infectious disease during the incubation period of the disease, as the name goes by. That is, they are capable of infecting other before the onset of the disease. For example, in this current COVID-19 pandemic also, large proportion are incubatory carriers who are shedding the virus, and they are they shed the infectious disease during the incubation period, and they are capable of infecting others before the onset of the illness. Apart from this, example, measles, mumps, pertussis, diphtheria are the other examples of incubatory carriers. Now, convalescent carriers, that is those who continue to shed the disease agent during the period of convalescence, that is during the clinical recovery period. Here the clinical recovery doesn't coincide with the bacteriological recovery. So clinically the patient seems to be asymptomatic, but he is harboring the agent or any microbial agent. That is the meaning of convalescent carrier. And then comes the healthy carriers. These are the victims of subclinical infection who develop carrier state without suffering from overt disease, without any clinical signs and symptoms, but are nevertheless they are shedding the microbial agent, disease agent. Example being typhoid, cholera, meningococcal meningitis, in which the disease is transmitted also by healthy carriers. A person whose infection remains subclinical may or may not act as a carrier. This is a very important point to be remembered. On the basis of duration, carriers can be classified into temporary carriers. They spread infectious agent for a limited period of time. They include incubatory carriers, convalescent carriers, healthy carriers. They can be permanent carriers. This is one who excretes the infectious agent over a long period of time, is known as permanent carrier. Many of these carriers can be seen in cases of typhoid. Longer the carrier state, greater is the risk to community, and carriers may excrete infectious agent intermittently or continuously. Duration of the carrier state varies with the disease. In typhoid, hepatitis, carriers can be several years. On the basis of portal of exit, carriers can be urinary, cases of typhoid, intestinal, cases of amoebiasis, respiratory carriers, example in tuberculosis, and here also in nasal, diphtheria. Now zoonosis, talking about the reservoirs, dealing with human reservoir, not animal reservoir. Whenever the term animal reservoir comes, the zoonosis term automatically pops up. So an infection or infectious disease transmissible under natural conditions from vertebrate host to man is known as zoonosis, and there are about 100 zoonoses which are transmissible to men roughly. The examples are many: rabies, anthrax, influenza. And what is amplifying host under animal reservoir is one which one by which enormous multiplication of the infectious agent in which enormous multiplication of the infectious agent takes place without the overt clinical disease. They are amplifying host. For example, in Japanese encephalitis, pigs, they act as amplifying host. In case of chlamydial infections, pigeons acts as amplifying host. Is one in which enormous multiplication activity of the enormous division multiplication of the microbial agent is happening without the overt clinical disease. there is evidence that genetic recombination between humans and animal viruses might produce new strain of viruses. We know now very well in cases of influenza how antigenic shift and drift happens. Soil can harbor infection that can cause tetanus, coccidioidomycosis and mycetoma. These are the examples. And in this, soil acts as a reservoir. So, modes of transmission we will deal in the next lecture. But you must go through these definitions. It is very important these definitions to understand the infectious disease epidemiology, because in the coming months and in the times to come by, infectious disease epidemiology is very interesting. It's going to be a very interesting topic and a focus of attention for all kind of people in the world. And an examination also, you can be asked these definitions. Okay, thank you. Have a nice day.